Thank you very much for the nice introduction and the opportunity to come to the suburbs of Baltimore here. It's only 1 hour drive, so it's really very convenient for us. As you have heard, a lot of my interest since 2002 has been about replacing animal testing and chemical safety toxicity. I also was responsible for the European Commission for their Center for Validation of Alternative Approaches, so how to assess the quality of these things and how to promote their use in industry. Just to give you a perspective cut, the Center for Alternative Animal Testing was created already in September, it will be 38 years ago. I like this t-shirt tag to introduce the center, which reads, "These t-shirts were tested on animals, they didn't fit." And this is exactly the type of situations where we want to come in and want to improve. So we are not objecting animal experimentation. We are also having a branch which does refinement of these, but it is about replacing them where newer technologies or better approaches can help. And this is possible because we are supported by a variety of companies, but also, much more importantly, 3 times more money comes from philanthropy, so this gives us a certain independence, and we enjoy the support of regulators, academic opinion leaders, and others in our board, which determines our work. Our experimental work is financed by the typical competitive sources, and this is very important to me. It's not just we say we replace animal testing and cash in money from philanthropic sources, but we have our research completely financed by competitive research. And if you miss the logo of your company here or have a rich uncle, I always find space on this slide to improve. I have to declare a few conflicts of interest. I will be talking in part about a mini-brain model, which is commercialized now by Axozym. I tried for a while to do this myself with a spin-off called Organome, which is now integrated in this company. And the computational work I'm describing is commercialized with UL Underwriters Laboratories, a safety standard organization, as you will probably know, which is also testing against these safety standards. And the other ones are less important here. So let's get started. This all is an economical environment. Toxicology takes place mostly in industry and contract research and between regulators and the regulated community. Academia does not really play such an important role. So the most important omics is economics. If you look into the big picture, according to Markets and Markets, we are spending $4.2 billion for animal-based toxicology at the moment, and about $14.4 billion for in vitro toxicology. So obviously, different to the image a general public has, there is some change taking place over the last decade. In vitro methodologies are actually taking over. But I'd like to spend a few minutes first to tell you how good is what you get for the $4.2 billion of animal studies. We published last year, based on a very large database which we created from the registration database of the European Chemical Agency, 10,000 chemicals with 800,000 associated toxicological studies. The majority GLP guideline studies according to OECD guidelines. So we identified for the 6 most frequently done toxicological tests, consuming in Europe, where we have the right statistics, 57% of all animals in toxicology. So we are talking about 600,000 animals and testing costs between 200 and 300 million. For these 6 tests, the 6-pack of toxicology, we found 350 to 750 chemicals which were tested more than twice. Sometimes shockingly often, we found 2 chemicals which were tested more than 90 times in rabbit eyes in the Dreyer's eye test. We found 69 chemicals which were tested more than 45 times in this assay. So it shows you the enormous redundance in testing. And this allowed us now to analyze how reproducible are these assays. The top of what you can get, GLP conducted assays only by skilled performers, mostly in contract research. And the reproducibility was 81%. Actually inflated very much because the negatives were negatives were negatives, but the positives very often were false negatives. If you looked only into the positive ones, the reproducibility was 69%. I think this is a very important measure telling you how good these assays are, what you get for your money, and they should actually open wide the door for new approaches to have something which you can rely on much better. And just to show you a few facts that this is not better for the more expensive studies, the systemic toxicities, which are not done as often. This is a study which I found very interesting. Wang and Gray analyzed in 2015 37 chemicals which were tested in the National Toxicology Program for Cancer. But they did not look at the cancer endpoints, but they looked into how well do mice and rats, females and males, correspond, and how well do they reproduce the historic findings which were available for systemic toxicity on these two. And the result is nothing correlated with nothing. Neither rats and mice, nor the organ toxicities between males and females, nor anything with the historic results. And if you look into, summarized in our paper from last year, in carcinogenicity, for example, you have an interspecies reproducibility between mice and rats of 57%. But this is not, does not mean the same organ cancer, it's just cancer or not cancer. You have 53% of all substances ever tested were positive. The same rate for drugs on the market as for any other type of substances. Ingredients of coffee, more than 60% were positive. And this, if you do some modeling, if you would use instead of 50, 200 animals, then you would have 92% positive results according to one study, because we are accumulating positive results with the number of tests we are doing. And the reproducibility of these assays itself is only about 57% for 121 chemicals which have been retested at about $1 million a piece. Yeah? Tells you something about the cancer bioassay. And no better for reproductive toxicity, 60% species correlation between various species. In rabbits, which are often used, you see sometimes in the background, in non-control, non-treated ones, 80% skeletal malformations. And it's very difficult to measure anything new as a malformation on the background of 80%. And for 1,200 chemicals, which were accumulated as probable, possible, or definitive animal teratogens, fewer than 2.3% were actually linked to any type of human data. So that's what we get for a lot of money. I've become active in the area of food safety and mainly food additive safety. Over the years, I was working with EFSA, European Food Safety Authority, when I was heading the validation body in Europe, but also now with more and more companies joining our center and supporting us. And most recently, I was interested in GMA's initiatives to create a new safety standard for grass, the generally recognized as safe system. I published on this last year. I have not the time to go into any level of detail if you want to tell you something new. What I took from this is that this is actually a system which is pretty rigorous at the higher concern levels. I was very surprised that it's all based on the Red Book of FDA from 1993, which is certainly outdated. There's very little adaptation to scientific progress over the last 25 years. So there's a lot to be done to integrate what other areas and sectors have been doing in order to promote this. What is evident is that the standards in execution from company to company, organization to organization, are quite different, especially with respect to publication. And I think you all are aware that, for example, the Pew Charity Trust demonstrated that for the majority of food additives, 80%, no public data are available to back their safety classifications. And this is probably also because there's too much waving, not only lack of publication of existing data, but a lot of safety assessments seem to include this. At the moment, there's little room for alternatives, so they're not really meeting the 3 R's commitment of the government and everybody, the scientific community. There's no use of evidence-based approaches, systematic reviews, meta-analysis, and these at least not foreseen in the GRAS regulation. And the standard is shockingly different to Europe. I mentioned EFSA already. In Europe, we have 390 food additives. 390. All of them have been assessed for safety with public data. Everything which has been registered before 2009 is still undergoing another re-evaluation until 2020. So all of these substances have to be evaluated. Is there new information? By comparison, We have about 4,500 direct food additives here in the US, and the majority has no such data. Okay, I was asked to talk not only about hazard, which is more my area of work, but I will talk a little bit about all of this. So this is a hazard. So basic toxicology says that hazard or risk is hazard times exposure, so only if you're exposed, you're actually in danger. No exposure is no risk. Yeah, that's a very simple one. If you talk about food, exposure is usually a given, but we hope it is little exposure. This is me and my sister when we were 5 and 3 years, respectively, with a little Lyme cup, as you can see. So we assume little exposure is little risk, but we should keep in mind that also little risk is not no risk. This is actually such a lion cub attacking a baby on television in one occasion. So you see, keep these things in mind. There is always exposure in case of the things we are discussing here. And also small risks are not no risks. So what is new in the 21st century with respect to exposome or exposure science? There's an enormous availability of sensors, which I will not touch, because it's not my area of expertise. There's a lot of biomonitoring taking place now, large cohorts being analyzed. There's a lot of modeling. The EPA even works on high throughput exposure assessments, so you come to more and more computational uses. And I will talk about two things which I find quite interesting in this context. One is exposome, and one is the threshold of toxicological concern concept, which you probably know, but which is expanding at the moment over what it used to be with respect to their use in mutagenic contaminants. The idea of the exposome is mainly to measure biomarkers in biofluid and look for the imprint of exposure. So you don't want to measure all of the different substances you could possibly be exposed to, but you simply say it is of interest if it leaves an imprint. And this imprint is not necessarily the substance itself, which is accumulating, but it is also the metabolic change, the genetic change, all of the biomarkers which we can measure. So the idea is that the exposome includes the pollutants, the toxicants, the metabolites of these endogenous metabolites, including the microbiome, RNA, microRNA, and other epigenetical markers. And by trying to assess the totality of these, the exposome is trying to characterize what is relevant exposure, not worrying too much about where and when, how much has been the people have been exposed to. And the idea is, I want it all and I want it now, so measuring as much as we can. And just to show you here, these are the levels of blood concentrations of relevant substances, endogenous and as well as exogenous. And you can see that this is spanning really more than 10 decades. So this is really a chemical analytical challenge. And most of you will have seen metabolomic type or spectra, which you can measure in biofluids. They look somewhat like this. And the problem is, how to identify now what these different features actually mean? Still, this is coming into toxicology. We've been reviewing the theme. We have also held 3 workshops so far on metabolomics in toxicology and 2 information days. This is all covered in articles, which I'm happy to send. By the way, I'm rushing you through a lot of material. I'm happy to provide my slides anytime, or if you want a paper you see here, I'm happy to send it. And most importantly, I think we have addressed the aspect of quality assurance of metabolomics because it's lacking behind other omics technologies very much. And I'm very excited this was taken up in 2017 by a consortium I'm involved with the FDA, NIH, National Center of National Cancer Institute, and LIST, the standard organization. Our first paper was just published on quality control and untargeted metabolomics studies, so something is happening here. And I really think that the exposure measurement by metabolomics, which is closest to the phenotype, closest to the effect, because a gene change does not mean that the protein changes. The protein change does not mean that this is impacting on the chemical reactions, but if the metabolites are changing, something has happened. So this is a really important one. And we have been discussing that this exposome center can actually benefit from the idea of combining it with mechanistic toxicology. I call this the human toxome, and I see a lot of possibilities in combining this mechanistical view on toxicology with the exposome idea, because it is trying to make sense behind the pattern of which these chemicals leave the biomarkers they leave in our blood. The human toxome was an NIH project which I had the pleasure to guide as the PI. The idea of this was to use in different omics type of technologies and find out how to make sense of all of these imprints, the transcriptomics, the metabolomics, how to interpret this. The project had 27 publications. Number 28 came out just a few months ago. And this is an example of using weighted gene correlation network analysis to reveal transcription factors behind the omics pattern left by bisphenol A, for example. So it's all about making sense of patterns. And this is actually transpiring to the world of exposomics. Dennis Sarijanis, a friend of mine and leading some of the exposomics activities in Europe, came up with this scheme, which is very similar to what we have been doing in the toxome, which is using untargeted metabolomics to form then a pathway of toxicity hypothesis, and using then targeted analysis to understand what this actually, is this correct, is the hypothesis true, or is it not true. We are establishing at the moment an exposome center in Hopkins. These are people in our team who are directing this, so we are trying to do more of this work. A different issue. Another trend, and this trend is impacting on both the exposure side and on the hazard side of the risk assessment paradigm, is big data. Big data is something which was it came to toxicology only most recently. I referred already to our work in 2016. We had downloaded the registration dossiers and there's robust summaries which are published on the ECHA website, and we received 10,000 chemicals and 800,000 studies. The problem is that these are all PDF, non-structured types of fields in a database, so it did require natural language processing to teach a computer how to read this information and extract it so that you get a database which can be really compiled. Tom Lichtenfeld did all of this work. This was about 500 pages of programming, but it was really led to remarkable visibility in the press some 3 years ago. This has helped us with improving on the threshold of toxicological concern concept. The idea of the thresholds of toxicological concern is shown in this picture over here. Here you see the no effect levels shown as logarithmic doses. And what you can see here is there is a minimum, these are the most potent toxic substances for a given health effect. And the idea is that you can actually say nothing will be more toxic than these substances. And this is the threshold of toxicological concern. And we did, argue on this aspect also in this Food for Thought paper about threshold of toxicological concern. But we show how this can be used and expanded. Here we publish with BASF on our database, expanding the concept of toxicological concern to prenatal developmental toxicity in rats and rabbits. And only now with the enlarged database, there were enough chemicals that you could actually establish a threshold of toxicological concern. And they're actually surprisingly high. So this might really give us an opportunity to reduce testing demands for certain substances in low concentration use. So let's talk about hazard. Let's come back to Tom's work. What we did, we expanded his database in the meantime in a collaboration with Underwriters Laboratories, UL, and created first the Reach Across, now it's called the UL Cheminformatics Toolkit. And the database was expanded to 10 million chemical structures. 300,000 of them have biological or chemical-physical data, and about 60,000 of them have animal data. It's probably the largest toxicological database in the world. When we published this, Nature and Science reported about it, but most importantly, ECHA did not like it. And this was what Nature was referring to, but only 2 months later, after publication, we met and we decided and agreed that this database is in the best interest of the public for chemical safety as well as for animal welfare. And in fact, 1 year later, ECHA published their database, so this is also now freely available. And more importantly, ECHA clarified that these data cannot be used for registration one-on-one, but they can be used in an aggregate way for computers like QSARs, quantitative structure activity relationships, to make a prediction. So it is possible to make use of this for a predictive tool. And this was one of the iconic figures of the publication. Science used this to illustrate the whole thing. These are skin sensitizers, the chemical universe of about 10,000 chemicals here. And you can see that chemical similarity is used here in order to, is shown as proximity. So two chemicals which are very similar are close to each other, and those which are distant from each other are very different. What you can see here in blue are skin sensitizers. And there's clearly some areas of the chemical universe where there is no skin sensitization, and there's others where there's big clusters of skin sensitization. And this shows very nicely that you can actually determine by what is the neighborhood of the chemical, what is most likely its property, and you can even express the certainty of your prediction. If there's only skin sensitizers around, you're pretty sure, and if there's positives and negatives, you're pretty unsure, and if they are distant, then you're less sure than if you have very close and very similar chemicals. We developed from this a technology which we call a RASA, a read-across-based structure-activity relationship, which tries to bring together the best of RASA, of read-across, which is very robust, only looking at the neighboring chemicals, and the QSAR, the computer-based execution. And this was then put forward by UL, first as read-across and then others. So what we did is we calculated such a landscape of the chemical universe of 10 million structures. And this actually took an Amazon cloud server 2 days of data crunching. This was $5,000 of computational cost to run this super matrix. But now, with only 0.5 billion calculations per prediction, you can put any chemical into this network. And you can do this with a normal computer, because you don't need to recalculate everything in seconds. So this is how it really looks like. We had to do 50 trillion comparisons for these 10 million compounds, because they're all with pairwise. I have to zoom in to show you. Now you can start seeing the substances. The distance is shown as chemical similarity, and now we can enter our data, positive, negative, or whatever we know. And by combining this, not only looking into irritants, if I want to know about irritation, but asking the computer, characterize all my neighbors by 74 different properties. Because a skin irritant is also an irritant. And a substance which is alkaline or acidic will also be an irritant. So a lot of information can help us. We developed now a data fusion model, as we called it. And this is the validation graph. Most probably will not see very much. These are now 9 of the most common assays. We also included aquatic toxicity and inhalation toxicity. This is the number of chemicals with animal data. So this is up to 48,000 chemicals for which we have irritation data, for example. An enormous database. And you see here the sensitivities and specificities in short from 190,000 predictions we made. So 190,000 cases where we took one of these chemicals out and said, if we had not known, what would be the result? We had 87% correct. This led to enormous interest when this was published in July last year. Nature and Science reported on it the same day, because it was a bit a moment like in 1996, when Gasparov was beaten by Deep Blue, IBM's computer, for the first time, which is on a much smaller level, obviously, but it was a case where you could show the animal is that good in the same study, on the same data sets, and we are that good with the computer, clearly outperforming the predictive power of a single animal test. The paper, according to this, the editor, was downloaded 24,000 times, which is never heard of in toxicology. Stefan Platz from AstraZeneca commented on this at the British Society of Toxicology. AI will not replace toxicologists, but those who don't use AI will be replaced by those who do. I hope he is right, but the FDA has already announced to assess this model. This is slides from the Society of Toxicology meeting in March. They want to assess this for food additives and for cosmetics first, so those where they have no pre-marketing authority. So they are going to sign, according to the FDA, in this month a contract for the evaluation of the software. I'm personally investing more into this. I assumed the role of editor-in-chief for Frontiers in Artificial Intelligence. I'm also for a year already editor for their section on medicine and public health. So I'm very much interested to pursue this because I think this is really a new kid on the block which deserves full exploration. So now, last part. I have two more parts. I want to show you in the next series of slides that cell culture is no longer what it used to be, petri dishes with a flat monolayer of the same cell types. And to use this, I'm using the mini brains we are working on, which are an example for the essentially all organs at the moment becoming available in. Becoming available in 3D with organ architecture and organ functionality. Our mini brains are done from human induced pluripotent stem cells. The work is funded by NIH and FDA, and MIT is evaluating it at the moment. These are little balls of cells which we are mass producing. We can produce about 2,000-3,000 in a simple laboratory setup per week. However, it is a 3-month process, so you have to go through this all. You can they're extremely reproducible in size and composition, and I will show you a few more features just to give you a flavor. These are different projects we are having. Different projects. I cannot go into any detail. But what you can see here is every time you see these sparks, one of the neurons is firing. So they are thinking. They are exchanging electrophysiological signals. And this can be used now to create a type of EEG on these mini brains. Here you see a mini brain within an electrode which has about 20 contact points. Another aspect which is quite fascinating is it's the first human model of myelination. So you see here how 40% of the axons are myelinated, oligodendrocytes wrapping themselves around here. We are interested especially into autism, and we believe that it is genetic background combined with exposure. So we are producing these risk genes for autism, and we're exposing them to substances like chlorpyrifos, which is believed to have an effect, and we see some synergies which are quite remarkable. We're studying also genetic backgrounds for Parkinson, Alzheimer's, and amyotrophic lateral sclerosis. We're adding cells, various types. You can see here added red fluorescent dopaminergic neurons for Parkinson research, or blood-brain barrier type coating these mini brains. In February, we published that we grafted them with glioblastoma, a very aggressive childhood cancer mainly, and you can use this now to find either new drugs or optimize the choice of drugs for a given patient. So this was published in Nature's online journal in February. So at the moment, a variety of micropathophysiological systems are developing, and I was, for example, also invited by ILCE Europe for the aging human brain to think about possible use of such type of methodologies. Our model is commercialized, was announced earlier this month by Axiosym, the mini brain model, if you're interested in commercial uses. A lot of our work at the moment is, however, about optimizing the quality assurance of these systems. So we took up good cell culture practice activities, drafting at the moment GCP 2.0 to cover these type of models. I just came back from Berlin, where we had a large workshop on validation and quality assurance of these. And we work also on in vitro reporting standards in order to improve this. The last point I would like to make, you need also a paradigm for change. And I believe that evidence-based medicine is an example for this. Since 2006, we have started evidence-based toxicology. We held the first conference in 2007. I have a chair in Hopkins now for 10 years, and since 2011 we are hosting the Evidence-Based Toxicology Collaboration. This is a way of handling in a very systematic and objective way information with systematic reviews. I don't have the time to explain systematic reviews, but I assume you have heard about this. And we're trying to work with agencies and other stakeholders to bring systematic reviews into toxicology. We just published last year a primer on systematic reviews, so type of cookbook. There's continuously conferences. Earlier this month, we had one with GRATE in Hamilton at McMaster. The European Food Safety Authority is having had one in 2017 in Lisbon with us, and one is coming up in 2019, and so on. We see that this is increasingly accepted. Most importantly, EFSA is in Europe the driving force for applying systematic reviews, but also FDA is interested, EPA is applying it, the National Toxicology Program and others. This is an interesting program. The spin-off of my PhD student is putting forward for semi-automated systematic review. This is something very easy to try out if you're interested in sysref.us. We also produced a second product, which is called ChemChart, which I would like to alert you of. ChemChart.com is a free service giving you the power of artificial intelligence to get information on chemicals, not only on safety and testing, but also where can you synthesize, how is this regulated in different parts of the world. And then I would like to close with that a lot of these things, if you'd like to learn more, are part of our teaching classes. And these teaching classes have been put for free on Coursera, the online plus mass teaching platform. And in the last year, already about 2,500 people have become active learners in our programs on evidence-based toxicology and on on toxicology for the 21st century. And I would like to close with economist John Maynard Keynes, who very rightly said, the difficulty lies not in the new ideas, but in escaping from the old ones. I hope I presented a few new ideas in the area of hazard identification and exposure assessment, so the risk assessment approaches, and I hope that we jointly can work towards change. Thanks a lot.